Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations. The Mobil Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
A few weeks ago, a prominent journalist wrote the following passage, quote, "Think, what other prominent elected official could say the following in front of 2,000 people and get away with it? A word that man said about Jimmy Carter. I happen to think he was one of the worst presidents we've ever had, probably worse than President Fillmore. Now, when he asked me to help, I said to him, oh, I'm going to vote for you, Mr. President. I'm a Democrat. Listen, I voted for George McGovern. I held my nose. Still, I voted for him, but I'm not going to campaign for you. So, the writer continues, Carter at the last moment modified his stance on federal takeover of Medicare, on Jerusalem, on offensive weaponry for Saudi Arabia, and Koch flew down to Miami as Jewish ambassador, and he said, I said at the airport, look, Carter changed his position, so that's why I'm here. And a very smart reporter said, why do you believe him? And I said, if he's lying, may he rot in hell. And I want to tell you, he was lying. The passage introduces the mayor of New York, Edward I. Koch. At this moment, historians may be uncertain whether he will be remembered primarily as the most spectacular mayor of New York since Fiorello LaGuardia, or whether he will be remembered as the author of Mayor, an Autobiography. The basic statistics are that his parents were Polish immigrants, that he went to law school, that he deposed Carmine DiSapio, that he was four times elected from the Silk Garment District, that he ran for mayor and won, ran for governor and lost, and that he is renowned for his energy, for his candor, and for his immense skills. Today we will discuss a view of the Democratic National Campaign as seen from New York City. Our examiner, about whom more in due course, is Mr. Peter Riddle, political editor of the London Financial Times. I'd like to begin by asking Mayor Koch whether, in his opinion, party loyalty is indispensable to personal political survival, and if so, how is it that Nelson Rockefeller and John Lindsay and Jacob Javits 20 years ago felt differently about this?
Well, I don't believe that party loyalty is essential. I believe it's important. And there are times when, I think it was John Kennedy who said, sometimes party loyalty demands too much. And almost everyone in high public office has departed from the party at some point in time. You can take Lindsay, for example. Lindsay, as you will recall, came in as a Republican, went out as a Democrat. Actually, he was
having been defeated in the primaries.
Yes, he was defeated in the primaries. And that's an interesting aspect, too. The primaries, regrettably, bring out the most militant in both primaries, the Republican and Democratic. In the Republican, it would be the most right-wing. So Lindsay lost because he was perceived as too liberal. In the Democratic primary, the most liberal or militantly liberal come out and have a greater impact on that primary than the broad number of Democrats who are basically mainstream and much closer to the center.
Well, I don't want to embarrass you by asking you your personal, what your personal calculus is as you see these data. But surely there must be some Democratic politicians who, surveying the ticket, feel they might be better off by not associating themselves with it, just as in the past we've seen a lot of people running for office who never advertise that they're Republican. They vote for Joe Blow, not Joe Blow, comma, Republican. Now, I remember when Barry Goldwater was in Garden City 20 years ago, he was 24 years ago, he was acting as the head of the re-election committee for the Republican Party, and somebody asked him at this very right-wing gathering whether he was endorsing Jacob Javits. And he said, yes, he was. And he added quickly, it's my job to endorse everybody. Is it your job to endorse anybody who's nominated by the Democratic Party?
No, I have departed from that, and it's rare that I would depart from it. There are several situations that have to be approached. One is that you broadly say that you support the Democratic ticket, and that's easy enough. In most cases, if asked for individual endorsements, you will generally give them, unless you know that the individuals are corrupt or incompetent, and it's been brought to your knowledge. But then there are particularly egregious cases where you think it's in the best interest of the city or the state or the government, the federal government, to cross party lines. I've done that. Let me just tell you, I did it in the case of John Lindsay.
Yeah, right.
When I was a Democratic district leader, I supported him because I believed that what he would have to offer would be very important. I was both right and wrong about it.
Why didn't you support me?
Let me just tell you, I thought, in fact, that you were the best in every case where you've been pitted in any situation. And this is not to flatter you, our politics didn't square. I liked you, like you now, but our politics don't square.
but your politics and John Lindsay's did?
At that time.
Uh-huh.
At that time.
That's before you became a militant?
No, it was before he showed incompetence.
Well, but incompetence and politics don't go hand in hand, do they?
No.
That is to say, you can have the right politics and be incompetent.
If you're someone who is perceived by me as vastly less than your opponent, in terms of competence, I'm not going to support you, even if you're the Democrat. I may not speak out against you,
right. But
I won't lend my name to someone who is incompetent. Now, I want to make it very clear. I happen to think that's not the choice that we have. Now, I honestly believe that Fritz Mondale and Jerry Ferraro are excellent candidates. I'm proud to be associated with them. I believe the Democratic Party and philosophy is to be espoused and better than the Republican one. That doesn't mean that I don't have a personal affection and respect for President Reagan. In fact,
sure.
I get people in my own party crazy, angry with me, because I will say I disagree with President Reagan's philosophy.
Yeah.
I deplore it. I like him personally. Yeah. There are some people who cannot distinguish between the political differences and the personal
liking. They want you just like anybody you disagree
with. Yeah, and I think that's crazy.
When you said Mayor Koch last August, a year ago, quotes, I don't find a single candidate who's heading in the right direction I'm talking about. What has Fritz Mondale done since then that has changed that?
Well, I believe that his basic positions are the positions that I would advocate, and we can take them up individually if you would like. And aside from the personal knowledge I have of his prior history, mm-hmm. as it related to what he did when he was a senator and a vice president, and then I was distressed that in the course of a primary, which everybody regrettably has to go through, that he was not taking the forceful mainstream positions that I would want him to take. I think he will now, having come through that exhausting fight involving the others. But then you have to compare him with the Republicans and the Republican primary. You know, President Reagan was repudiated at the Republican convention. Matters that he said ought not to be taken up were, in fact, imposed upon him. I thought the battle in Dallas with the Republicans was a battle between the far right and the savage right, and I believed that the savage right would ultimately win there, and they did.
Well, thank heavens.
I disagree
on
that.
You don't want a bland ticket, do you? savagery did you see coming out of Dallas?
Well, I believe that when a party believes that it alone is the party of patriotism, and that Democrats, for some reason or other, are not patriotic, it's an outrage. I'm affronted by that. And when you watched them in action and you heard their rhetoric, I believe that that was the message that they were conveying. It was very much the message of Barry Goldwater in 64 when he said, or at least is alleged to have said, you can saw off the eastern seaboard and send it back to Europe. You remember that?
I do, yeah.
I thought that was so outrageous. And in a sense, what the Republicans were doing, and I don't believe that Reagan wanted them to do it, frankly. I believe the savage right decided it was going to impose itself on the party. You had people like Lowell Weicker. I mean, the man was embarrassed being there. In fact,
but he's embarrassed being a Republican.
Maybe so. Yeah. I don't think so. I think he, and I'm not here to sing his song,
sure, sure.
But I believe that he perceives himself, as do most people, Republicans or Democrats, different in philosophy, but very much in the mainstream, and that what we saw in Control in Dallas was the extreme, I referred to it as the savage right in Control.
Well, Mayor Koch, I think you're committing a logical fallacy. I'm trying to remember which one it was. Maybe it's the compound fallacy. Notre Dame has a very good football team. Johnny is a member of Notre Dame, therefore Johnny is a good football player. If you say the Republicans charge that there's lack of patriotism, therefore they're charging me because I'm a Democrat with lack of patriotism, is to commit that fallacy.
Maybe so.
It's on the other direction. John Stuart Mill was once very offended when he said, all stupid people are conservatives. And he said conservatives shouldn't bother about that because if they have all the stupid people on top of some of the non-stupid people, that guarantees them a comfortable majority. my point, therefore, is that it is, I think, correct, isn't it, that there was heard in San Francisco and during the primaries certain negative notes which you used to denounce during the Vietnam days.
I still do.
But those are people who rise successfully in the ranks of the Democratic Party.
Let me say that I disagree with some of the positions taken by the spokespeople. I'm not now talking about Mondale or Ferraro, because I believe that they and I are in accord. For example, one of the platform planks that I disagree with is the one that comes out for racial quotas.
Mm-hmm.
I denounced it at the convention, but I know that Fritz Mondale opposes racial quotas and has said so publicly. But if you look at...
So he didn't control his any more than Reagan controlled his, is that it?
I agree with that. I didn't say that Reagan was responsible for Dallas.
You said that he didn't control his own party.
To the same, I believe there was greater control exercised by Mondale, but not the full control.
Not conclusive. Uh-huh.
That there was far less control. A runaway convention in Dallas. They really didn't care what the president's position was on a number of issues.
Mm-hmm.
For example, I think on ERA, even though he's against ERA, I don't think he wanted the platform to say that.
Mm-hmm.
And nevertheless, they were going to shove it to the president. They were in control.
Yeah. Well, now you said, you wrote in Public Opinion in 1983, we, meaning the sensible Democrats, adopted sensible, moderate positions on issues of foreign policy and defense. But by early spring, we began to see signs in our party of a relapse into the follies of the McGovern-Carter era, with the extremists and elitists taking over once again.
Yes, I think that's true.
Did they cease to take over?
No. I don't believe that their positions have been adopted by Fritz Mondale. But I wouldn't for a moment say to you that there aren't significant people in the Democratic Party who take positions that I deplore.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that some of those who were running, there were only two others, Jackson and Hart, in their foreign policy were quite bad. Jackson worse than Hart, but Hart also isolationist in part. Jackson much worse, and I am convinced that the positions of Hart and Jackson are not the positions of Fritz Mondale. You know, it's not a monolithic party.
Well, when you said that Carter was the worst president since President Fillmore, and since we know that Mondale was his vice president, what has Mondale done to distinguish himself from the Carter record that reassures the American people?
Well, the first thing is I believe that the reason that Carter will go down as one of the worst presidents is that in a moment of emergency, Iran and the taking of hostages, he went into a blue funk that could only be described as a depression, which made it impossible for this country to react responsibly, in my judgment. The fact is that the vice president is not in a position to take the place of the president unless the president is removed under, I think it's the 25th Amendment. So you cannot hold him accountable for that. I can only tell you that on all of the occasions that I saw Fritz Mondale when I was a member of Congress and he was a senator and vice president, and then when I became the mayor and he was vice president, I always found his comments on matters as they related to the urban areas which I was interested in, national foreign policy, as responsible as in the mainstream. And I said to him in the book, which you were kind enough to mention at the opening of the show, I had a conversation with him, as you may recall, and this is back in 1980, when I said to him, paraphrasing now, I said, Fritz, the reason I'm supporting Carter is not because I want Carter. It is because Carter told me that you are his candidate next time round. And I said it then, and I'm happy that it turned out that way on this occasion.
So you always distinguish between the two.
Yes, you have to.
When you saw them in action.
Yes.
Well, what I'm anxious to put my fingers on is, what is it that singles Mr. Mondale out for escaping from this legion that you denounced comprehensively a year ago? Mm-hmm. You didn't say everybody but Mondale was pointing in the right direction. You said everybody. And then at that time, Mondale was way out ahead.
I'll tell you, well, at that time, you may recall,
Kennedy hadn't withdrawn. Yeah.
I also said that it would be almost an open convention. I predicted an open convention. It almost was, you know.
You're right, right.
I was one of the few who held back and said I wanted to see what was happening. And I endorsed Fritz Mondale a couple of weeks before the convention occurred, because I wanted to put their feet to the fire. I understand, having gone through many primaries, I think I've been myself in 14 different elections since I first entered public office, and I understand the difficulty it is that you have when you're faced in a primary with others who will take the most demagogic points of view in order to get the nomination. And I'm not going to tell you that I approved of everything that he did in the course of getting that designation. I understand the compromises that were necessary. I believe now, having gotten the designation, that he will in fact do the things that I saw him do when he was free to do them as a senator, less free as a vice president, because you're in the shadow of the president.
Well, this is an act of faith, isn't it? This requires one to say, well, Mayor Koch, knowing this man better than we do, having observed him in action at close quarters, knows that he will be able to shrug off those extreme statements with which he is constantly associated.
Well, I want to make the point that while the Democratic Party has people in it who take positions that I've disagreed with for many years and spoken out in opposition to them, George McGovern, Jesse Jackson, others of that vein, there are fewer in our party than you would find of the opposite radical right point of view dominating the Republican Party. The Jesse Jacksons, the Gary Harts, the George McGoverns do not dominate the Democratic Party. The people on the right in the Republican Party, I believe, do dominate it, and showed that domination when they took the platform and took it away from the president, who, after all, wasn't even vying with another candidate. He didn't have to cater to anybody, and yet they imposed it on him.
Well, you have something of a professional obligation to denounce as radical a platform which is primarily pointed to as radical for believing that the Supreme Court was wrong in saying that certain things were legal which had been illegal, or illegal which had been legal for 200 years. To say you want prayer in the schools, I don't think really is very radical myself.
Let me say this. Let me give you the most radical.
Yeah, okay? Abortion.
No. you know, on positions of abortion, I happen to be supportive of the Supreme Court decision. I don't like abortion, but I believe that just as the Supreme Court didn't like abortion, they believed that it is the right of a woman in consultation with a doctor under certain conditions to decide whether or not she wanted one.
I've never met anybody who liked abortion. They always anticipate what they say by saying what you said.
Well,
I don't have to like abortion.
I'll give you another. I don't happen to like the death penalty, but I'm for it.
Yeah.
Because I think that there's a higher social purpose, even though the death penalty qua penalty isn't something I would say I like.
Well, I'm not for spinach, but I feel one has to eat spinach. But doesn't really.
No, but I don't think it's fair. No. I think I'm saying when you deal with a very important matter, I'm not faulting the Republican Party representing, in that case, probably a majority point of view in that party, mm-hmm. in opposition to abortion. You have a right to have that in your plank. But let me give you one. And you have a right to put any of these in your plank. But then we have a right to view them as to whether or not they're radical rights.
Sure.
The one that I think most people will be offended by is that one of their planks says there shall be no public funding of the federal elections. Now, you know, when we hear so many times how difficult it is for candidates to raise funds and the problems that they get into when they do raise funds, to have a party at this point in time to say that it is coercive for there to be federal funding of presidential campaigns, and that's what one of the planks is a throwback.
Well, but something isn't necessarily a throwback, isn't necessarily radical if it's a throwback, is it?
Well, I believe when you reach a point where most people would say, this makes sense, this is responsible, and if you have someone coming in or a party coming in almost out of the blue saying, no, we want to go back to the Neanderthal era, that's a throwback.
Well, the Neanderthal era was also the era where the Bill of Rights, for instance, were
that's a comeback.
Were stitched. Aha! I see why you're a successful politician. No, but it seems to me that I'm trying to think of what the desolation in America was before we had federal funding for education, which is about for elections, which was what, 12 years ago, was mm-hmm. it? I can't remember that Roosevelt had any difficulty raising money, or Dewey, or Truman, or Eisenhower, or Kennedy.
No, you didn't have a problem raising money.
We bullied through.
You didn't have a problem raising money. The question was, what were the commitments you made to raise it? And that is why people decided I was there
Mayor
when the Congress
Koch.
Did it.
Mayor Koch, you're talking about commitments made. Never in the history of democracy has there been a more obvious leaning towards lobbying interests than by Fritz Mondale. Everybody talks about it, even Democrats talk about it. He goes to the teachers today and to educators tomorrow and to Irish the next day and Jews the next day.
Well, so does President Reagan. Nothing wrong with that.
Well, you say nothing wrong with it, but you're suggesting that the purpose of federal funding was to avoid that kind of thing.
It seems
to have accentuated it.
Let me just say that funding heretofore prior to public financing made it impossible for people who were not well known to run at all at that level. In New Jersey, they have public financing for governors, I believe, and I think they had 20 people run. Probably it was helpful to the system. I am suggesting that to take away public financing from the presidential level is a major step backwards.
Well, Mr. Etzioni was on this program a month ago. He just finished writing a book on the subject, and he said, now, he's denouncing the laws that permit spending more than X. That's his particular shtick.
Mm-hmm.
But, said he, do you realize, Mr. Buckley, that since federal funding, the amount spent on elections has risen by more than federal contributions to it? So whereas, let's say, we were spending X 12 years ago, Y was contributed by the government, we're now spending X plus Y plus Z. So that the federal funding would seem not to have helped things at all. How much are you going to spend on running for mayor next year?
Well, if we can raise it, probably about $3 million.
Is that all?
I wish there was city funding, but there isn't.
Well, that's interesting. If there were city funding, you'd probably spend six. And if you're satisfied with only 75% of the vote, that's kind of redundant.
Well, I hope to achieve what I did the last time, but it's very hard. If you've been in office for near 7 years, as I have been, and you've taken some very tough decisions,
sure.
You have to make enemies.
Sure.
People who don't understand or agree that you, in this case me, believe that what I'm doing is in the best interest of 7.5 million people. You know, it depends on whose ox is being gored.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a responsibility to bring this city back from fiscal irresponsibility, and I think I've done it, and I would like to continue to do it.
Well, I don't think there's much dissent in this audience on that proposition, but so we've decided that Dallas showed itself to be an enclave of savage radical
the
Republicans
savage right.
because they came out against federal funding.
I gave that as one illustration. Even take taxes.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it just shows how irrational they are. Here, the president's position is, well, he's not going to raise taxes. But his people in Dallas say, but don't put me in a box that under no circumstances, irrespective of what happens in this country, I can under no circumstances raise taxes.
You
and that's
that,
what they
you?
Did.
You agree with that, don't you?
That under no circumstances?
No. I mean, you agree that nobody should say under no circumstances anything.
Right.
You can't
even but the Republicans basically said that in their platform on taxes.
Well, I think that...
That's irrational.
For instance, there was Pearl Harbor the next day. There probably had to be higher taxes.
I know, but it's irrational.
I agree. It's rational. But it was intended to make a political point, right? Because what was being contended at that particular moment was the seriousness of their commitment on taxes. But now, for instance, the most radical reform in taxes that I've heard in my lifetime is the flat rate tax.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't even dare to do that, but you have. You were quoted in 1883-7.
Mm-hmm.
Mayor Koch said he would propose a version of the flat rate federal income tax that many other politicians in his party are discussing.
Right, it's the Bradley Gephardt
flat
rate. I'm for that. You are too.
Absolutely.
Sure.
But it's considered extremely radical. But some ideas are completely radical, especially when you've gone in radical directions in the other way.
I honestly think that the Bradley Gephardt flat tax is now mainstream America and that the Congress will ultimately enact it. I don't think it's radical anymore.
Do you think Mr. Mondale would endorse it?
If he hasn't, he should.
Well, not only has he not, he's gone in the opposite direction. He wants to stop indexation, which would mean that middle-income people would be hurt and would be put once again at the mercy of inflationary bracket creep. He wants a surcharge on incomes over $60,000 of 10%. So it's not obvious, since this would yield practically no revenue, as you know, it's not obvious where the money is supposed to come from. Aren't we really at the mercy here, Mr. Koch, of what we might call necessary excesses by politicians in an age that seems to reward moral exhibitionism?
Well, I think you're right that many politicians perceive that that's the way they have to respond. Maybe I'm looking at it through different glasses. I don't think I do it that way, and I'm not singing my own song. I rely on the common sense of people. I believe that if you do what makes common sense, that ultimately people will support it, even if they don't like it at the moment that you're doing it. That's my honest impression of my political career and life. And I know that if you want to do a good job, that you cannot take a poll on a controversial matter before you decide what you're going to do. Do what's right as you perceive right, then take your poll. That's what a superb politician, and by politician I mean one in public office, should do.
Well, do you think under the circumstances it's distinctly courageous of Mr. Reagan to come out against abortion, inasmuch as his aides have told him time after time, look, if there have been 39 million abortions, 3.9 million abortions since you became president, that's that many people whom you are insulting by pleading that they were guilty of immoral conduct. Now, is this an example of somebody who thinks what he wants to do and what is right, and then simply faces the ugly consequences of it?
I believe that if you are opposed to abortion under any circumstances, and there are people who have that position, and I suspect the president has that position, I don't know of any permission, so to speak, under the amendment that they're proposing, you should take that position. Matters of morality, and you can be moral on both sides of a matter. The death penalty is one. You can be moral being for it or against it, abortion being for it or against it, racial quotas being for it or against it. There are certain gut matters where even if you lose an election, you should stand up and support a moral position. Mm-hmm. Never, ever retreat. Even in this case, where the position advocated by President Reagan is one that I disagree with. Mm-hmm. I respect his right. I would, frankly, be distressed if I knew that that was his position and if he hid behind some veneer and didn't advocate it.
Mm-hmm. Well, in one of your statements, you said that you disliked especially critics of certain policies who felt that you had to go to the point not only of criticizing those policies, but criticizing anybody who held them. This would be a case in point, wouldn't
it? Right, exactly so.
So, in other words, you can be against the death penalty without feeling that everybody who's in favor of the death penalty is
murderous. Would be the other way around. I happen to be for the death penalty because I think it's protective of society, and I resent it when the opponents, who happen, by the way, to represent about 30% of the point of view in this country, 70% of the people in this country, black and white alike, are in support of the death penalty. They have a right to be against it, but they ought not to attack my integrity because I am for it. I don't attack theirs.
Well, now, I heard an awful lot of oratory in San Francisco, as did you, by prominent Democratic leaders, including Mr. Mondale, who very thoroughly criticized not only the policies of Mr. Reagan and of his supporters, but their motives. He implied that everybody who supported Mr. Reagan was simply greedy, that he wasn't interested in the environment, that he wasn't interested in the poor, that he wasn't interested in peace. Aren't there different ways of saying that than to suggest that the people themselves are guilty of mens rea?
I would agree. I am offended whether the oratory, the rhetoric comes from my candidates or from the other side, the Republicans, when it's ad hominem, when it attacks integrity, when the attack should not be made. It's bad. I mean, I have found, it's regrettable that in the political area, whether it be the candidates or the observers or the campaigners or those who just simply cover the election, that the dialogue has, and the discourse, better word, has fallen to such a terrible low level, and I'm distressed with it.
Well, are the consequences as you predicted they were not long ago when you wrote, quotes, "Today there are some Democratic candidates who have taken responsible positions, but who, when they see crowds of extremists running at them, fear getting run over. So they run to the head of the angry crowd and start yelling along with them. That is not the way you get elected president in this country." Yeah. Is this what's going to happen to him for doing that, for violating Koch's law?
I don't think so. I believe that while Fritz Mondale is not without fault or blemish, that the blemishes are fewer than those carried by the Republican contender, in this case the president, Mr. Reagan.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask you this before we turn to our examiner, Mayor Koch. Do you feel that it is simply a part of what you hear every time there's an election, or is it distinctively true this time around? Because both Reagan and Mondale said it was, that this is a very important election, i.e. that the future of America is likely to be oriented strategically by the results.
I do believe this is an extremely important election. I'll tell you what advice I gave Fritz Mondale, who called me not very long ago. I said I would drop all of your commercials that you intend to have, and I would simply play the voice of President Reagan when he did his Uncle Don bit, where he said he had declared the Soviet Union illegal and bombing was going to start in 5 minutes. That was either his fantasy or that was what he really would like to do if he had the opportunity to do it. In either case,
it's unlawful, just another broken promise.
But the fact is that that kind of what people say, well, it was just humorous. It's the kind of humor that we cannot afford in someone who has the power to carry it out. I believe that this is an election which will deal with life and death, peace and war. Doesn't necessarily mean that if we were to lose that it must automatically occur that way, but the danger is there, and therefore I think this is a very important election.
Nick, that's the only humorless thing I've ever heard you say in the 15 years I've known and loved you. President Andrew Jackson once said, the only thing I regret as president is that I didn't hang Calhoun and shoot Clay. Now, he didn't mean he was going to hang his own vice president, shoot Clay. It's just the way some people talk sometimes.
I must say that while other mortals not having the power to destroy another country might be able to engage in comparable hangman's humor, the president cannot.
Well, then you're talking about taste. But unless you're going to be give me a deep Freudian reading.
Can I have a president who has taste?
Yes, you do. You do. You have a president has pretty good taste. Anybody who gets shot and acts the way he did,
oh, yes,
pretty good
taste.
Oh,
with great style.
But you don't want to suggest that you have a Freudian reading here that says, you see, this is really what he wants.
I'm
can't imagine why anybody wants to be president in order to end the existence of the White House, let alone of himself, do you?
I'm suggesting fantasy or fact. It was the kind of statement based on also his other dealings with the Soviet Union that, in my judgment, place him in a position that I would not want him in the next 4 years. I would prefer someone who is never willing to sell America short, never willing to have our defenses less than those able to respond to a Soviet aggression, but nevertheless willing to sit down and deal with a country that we don't like, but nevertheless have to live with.
There goes Abraham Lincoln when he suggested all his generals become alcoholics. I think I see your point. And if I were a Democrat, for purely opportunistic reasons, I keep reminding them to say this. However, I don't really think the people who take the measure of Mr. Reagan would be very carried away by it.
We'll
but let's see. Let's hear from Mr. Peter Riddle. Mr. Riddle is as I said, the political editor of the Financial Times in London, a former president of the Cambridge Union, an author and the economist and journalist of great note, Mr. Riddle.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Mayor Koch, you've several times talked about the mainstream, which is, you know, clearly what you believe in, and you tried to draw within to the mainstream the current Democratic platform. But haven't you left something out of account? The very bitter arguments you had during the spring and early summer within your party between Senator Hart and Vice President Mondale over the nature of policy, leaving aside what Jesse Jackson was arguing, even within the mainstream of the Democratic Party, there are bitter arguments about what the nature of policy should be.
There's no question about that. I believe that Gary Hart was basically citing and reciting policies that I would refer to as isolationist in tone. And fortunately, they were repudiated. Mondale won.
Yes, but on economic policy, let's take that issue. Mr. Buckley's referred earlier to Mr. Mondale's links with organized labor and various interest groups, and Senator Hart was advocating a different policy, in many respects one which you wouldn't be too far from what you've done for mayor for the last 7 years in stimulating competition, cutting back in parts of the public sector.
Well, let me talk about that in this way. Labor, organized labor, is when it comes to collective bargaining, wages and benefits, it's a special interest. But it also has a broad interest and has demonstrated that interest as it relates to national defense and other social matters that don't concern themselves with collective bargaining, and in that sense, very much should be listened to. As it relates to Gary Hart's proposals, I'm going to be very honest about this. I never heard a fleshed out proposal. I only heard the word new, but I never heard new what.
Yes, for example, his attitudes on opposing import restrictions, opposing import quotas, freer trade policies, boosting competition.
Well, I am for competition, and I am also someone who would like to describe himself as once a free trader, but now believes that while free trade should exist, it should never exist at our expense based on subsidies provided by foreign countries to their exporters. In England, the government owns the coal mines. You want to get out of that business. You own the steel mines, but the steel mills. And the fact is that you're able to sell coal or steel or other products with a subsidy. We don't own them, and therefore we are at a disadvantage.
But there are various ways of subsidizing. I mean, I think we don't want to get into the argument about steel or coal, but there are various ways in which steel and U.S. steel and coal are heavily subsidized by different means, even if they're not openly. But if I come back to the point, isn't really the battle for the identity of the Democratic Party still going on? And the victory of Mr. Mondale as being the candidate is, in a sense, lost over that. He won on certain platform things in San Francisco. But the argument about where the Democratic Party stands in relation to various interest groups is still all there for 88.
Of course, because the Democratic Party is a broader umbrella than the Republican Party. In the Democratic Party, you will have people like myself. I like to think of myself as in the mainstream and representing the vast majority of Democrats. But you will have people who will be on my right and others who will be on my left. In the Republican Party, I think it's fair to say you will have people on the right and people who are on the far right, and that's the difference. That is why there are more Democrats in this country. You know, there are physically more Democrats. It is only when the Democratic Party's philosophy is perceived as not reflective of the Democrats that the Democrats walk out of the party, as they did under George McGovern's sovereignty, if you will, and walk over to the Republican. Or again, when they had a choice between a person who they perceived as a non-leader, Jimmy Carter, and someone who they didn't know, but knew that he couldn't be any worse than what we had.
Mr. Buckley, what do you feel? Do you feel that Mr. Koch's mainstream is in the mainstream of the Democratic Party, or is it coming in a redefined Republican Party umbrella?
I think to a certain extent, the parties have been kind of fungible, particularly during the past 30 years. I think on the whole, the Democratic Party, rather than the Republican Party, has been the intellectual leader of American politics. 95% of what the Republican Party believes in right now would be denounced as unthinkable radicalism 30 years ago, 40 years ago. So on the whole, the movement has been to the left. It is that ascent is lessening, and that's really what the fight is about.
Yes, I'm talking about the last 4 years.
Well, under Reagan, we're spending 24% of the GNP on national expenditures. The highest we did under Carter was 22.9, I think, 23 perhaps. So that even pulling hard at the harness, Mr. Reagan has not been able to stop the inertial inertial run towards an ever increasing segment of the GNP being devoted to public purposes.
No, but my point being, in part, is not only that experience, which is very similar to that in Britain, but also that what Mr. Koch has advocated in practice is, how different is that from what you might term as now being mainstream Republicanism?
Well, mainstream Republicanism is associated by people with my age as the dullness of the Eisenhower years, Dewey years. It wasn't really until Barry Goldwater 20 years ago that some breath of life flowed into the tired veins of the Republican Party, and people began to get sort of fresh visions. This flat tax business, you'd have been hooted down as a pre-Taft reactionary for suggesting that taxes ought not really to be progressive. But that's a fresh idea, but it's not associated with the mainstream, not yet. Maybe Mr. Koch is correct. that will be mainstream a year from now. I hope he's correct.
But does the Democratic Party need a Goldwater-like figure to inject fresh life into it? Hasn't the last year shown divisions which need some figure?
No. I mean, we have the debate, the intellectual debate. We have the diversity. You have Jesse Jackson. I deplore his positions as they relate to foreign policy and domestic policy. But he has a right to espouse them, and he is part of the Democratic Party, and he should be listened to and should be argued with. So we don't need what Mr. Buckley was suggesting the Republicans needed, is someone who said something worth responding to. We have those people.
But doesn't, Morse gets the feeling that in trying to define what the mainstream is, the nearer one gets, the more jelly-like it gets in a way. And I can see what you've done in New York as mayor for 7 years and what you stand for, but you almost be trying to protect your whole party by that.
Yeah. And
that
you're Let me tell you what I stand for in just two words. Liberalism with sanity. Mm-hmm. I believe that is exactly what I have advocated
for years. That's three words.
Liberalism with sanity is three words. I believe that is mainstream Democratic politics. Now, in the primaries, we don't have that. Regrettably, 25% of the people come out who are eligible to vote. And they will be the single-issue voter, people who are oriented towards radicalism.
Bella Abzug types.
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Throughout the program, you've been saying, right, we've had our arguments on the Democratic Party, but ultimately we can carry on, we can agree. What we can do is we can have our differences, we can debate them during the primary campaign, then we come to San Francisco, someone wins on the platform, we elect a candidate, then we can all go forward to November.
Sure.
But aren't you trying to really disguise quite deep divisions within that? That your definition of the mainstream covers a wide variety of differences on particular issues. As you made clear, when particular issues come up, say on Jesse Jackson, you say, no, I disagree with him. Or one or two points with Fritz Mondale, no, I disagree with him. And therefore it loses meaning.
But I don't think so. You're suggesting that our politics be closer perhaps to the British, and I don't know whereof I speak, and I should hesitate to do it, but I think, watching all those movies, that the British parties are very monolithic. We are not. We cover an umbrella of groups, or there's an umbrella covering those groups, and I prefer it that way. Our politics in the mainstream of the Democrats and the Republicans, and I think we have more in our party for the reasons I've already given you, are closer to the center, common sense, reasonableness. But we still have in both parties the radicals, smaller in number, and on the left in the Democratic Party, large and dominating the party on the radical right, or as I have said, the savage right in the Republican Party.
It isn't also a factor that, I mean, you're right, you talk about the decentralized nature, the broad nature of American parties, a more candidate-based system and so on. I mean, you after all did get the backing of both the Democratic and Republican parties in 81 when running again for mayor. But isn't it also a factor that when you talk about the mainstream, all right, you're saying this because we're running up to the election, but isn't it almost a matter of saying mainstream in one city? Like the Soviet Union used to talk about socialism in one country for a period during the 20s and 30s.
You know, is it a parochial
Yes, is it,
reading?
Is it liberalism with sanity in one city?
I don't think so. I believe that as I've espoused what it is that I do, that you would find that in America across the country. Go to Dianne Feinstein and you will find in San Francisco, I believe, basically the same kind of approach to politics and the public good as I've espoused them here.
Mr. Buckley, do you feel that the Democratic Party has learnt the lessons of the 70s and it's now coming forward with a sharper challenge as it did?
I think it has learned some of the lessons of the 70s. Lyndon Johnson, you may or may not remember, ran in 1964 on the grounds he was going to improve the quality of human life. And that was sort of the ultimate eschatological presumption. And people finally woke up and recognized that liberal politics can't substitute for human life. It can't educate you. It can't make you more moral, more loyal to your family. And so I think there was been a great disillusionment with liberalism during the past generation, but I don't think something has yet come in to take its place. The conservatism has never been a redemptive creed, as you know. So we offer primarily methods by which to contain the government, contain the courts, contain the police, but not really a vision. And for that reason, it lacks the glamour of Marxism or even of liberalism.
Even our songs are better than yours.
Gee, I didn't know we had any.
That's what I mean.
Yeah, well, in Dallas, you were adopting Happy Days Are Here Again. You were stealing it from the Democrats. But isn't the point on that, that there is quite a variety of voices coming through in the Democratic Party?
But that's good.
But you also got to, at some stage, to have an agreed view on what the role of the state is on foreign policy. Yeah. So you yourself said, during the whole run-up to San Francisco, Jesse Jackson and Gary Hart were saying totally different things
right.
from Walter Mondale.
Yes.
They also got a very, very wide support in the Democratic Party. All right, they lost in the end, but it was only in the end.
Wide support of the activists, as I said to you, regrettably, in our primaries, a very small number come out. The figure is 25%, and they dominate to a greater extent than they would in a general election. But nevertheless, with all of that, the candidate who represents mainstream Democratic politics, in my judgment, did prevail. Fritz Mondale.
Yes, he prevailed, but despite and over the doubts of quite a large section of the party. I mean, do you think those numbers in the 25% who came out during the spring and summer in primaries to vote for Gary Hart and Jesse Jackson, are they going to stick with the ticket?
Oh, they have no place to go.
They can come to us.
No, they can't.
I mean, we've got a great big tent.
What I said to Fritz Mondale, but you don't let everybody in the tent. What I said to Fritz Mondale when he asked my advice, and I was grateful that he did, I said, you don't have to worry about Jesse Jackson. He can stay home, and nevertheless, his supporters will go to the polls and vote for you because they know it means the difference in their life style and in the responses of government to them in the next administration. And I also predicted, by the way, at the convention, I said Jesse Jackson's going to end up like a lamb. People said he's going to walk out and he's going to have his own party. I said, no, he will not. He will support Fritz Mondale. He will seek to get concessions, which I don't believe will be given to him, and I hope are not given to him. But ultimately, he has no choice. If he were to say to every one of his supporters, and they're overwhelmingly black community people in this country, if he were to say to every one of them, stay home, they wouldn't stay home. How do we know that? Because there was a poll recently taken. 88% of the black citizens of this country say they're going to vote for Fritz Mondale.
What about Gary Hart supporters? Because wasn't Gary Hart reaching out from traditional Democratic base to those who are doing quite well, successful people? Will they necessarily stay? Might they not?
Well, I never really understood who his supporters were. They were called yuppies. I've never met. Is that what they call yuppies?
I think so.
Yuppies.
Yeah.
More like puppies. I believe that they will do what John Anderson did. I mean, that's the crew that probably comprised his supporters, the John Anderson.
Mr. Riddell, I think the mayor here has a problem. We ought to help him out. He starts off by saying to every newspaper in the history of the world that the direction that all of the leaders of the primary campaign are taking is suicidal, that they're all acting like a government. Then he tells us here that that's the way people act in campaigns, don't you understand? Because they have to appeal to these suicidal people. Then he tells us that the guy who won that contest is mainstream. Now, you have to repeal one or the other of those central contentions.
No.
Otherwise, you're contradicting
yourself. No, what I tried to do, and I think successfully, was to keep the feet of the candidates to the fire by speaking out. I believe that Fritz Mondale did on occasion say things that I didn't agree with for whatever reasons, but overall, there's no question in my mind that with respect to the largest number of issues that I call mainstream democratic politics or mainstream America, he and I are in accord. I only regret that people, including Fritz Mondale and so many others, on occasion do make concessions. Fortunately, I don't believe that there were any substantial concessions made in the course of the primary which would prevent him from doing what I know he will do based on his prior record when he becomes the president.
Yes, now on a slightly different topic, one which you touched on, your point on election spending, which strikes any observer from Britain as an absolute vast amount of money, But why don't you tackle, which is quite simply the answer which is adopted in Britain, banning advertising on television? Because that's the major outlet
sure,
of spending.
Sure, and I'm for that. I am for the five-week election, which I think you have for Parliament. Here, the elections go on for more than a year. It's outrageous. When I was in the Congress, those issues were debated. I don't believe that we're able to marshal the political support for it. The best we were able to do, and I was on the House committee that brought in the legislation that imposed limits on how much anyone could contribute, and also providing for the federal funding of presidential and vice presidential campaigns.
But all the evidence shows that's led to massive abuse. I mean, through political action committees of various kinds, and there's competition in self-righteousness seems to be in this year, and saying who isn't taking PAC money and who is.
It should be amended and changed where the abuses show. I doubt that there's a single law that's ever been enacted where after a period of time you couldn't show abuses. Our job is to eliminate the abuses.
I'm not 100% certain that we wouldn't have constitutional problems.
Under freedom of speech.
Yeah. You don't have that problem of constitutional. Yeah.
We're an organic society. We're a true conservative society in that way.
That's right. You just have an occasional bloodless revolution. But would we have any trouble with the First Amendment banning television advertising?
Probably. We know that there are limits on what you can restrain, because the Supreme Court struck down the provision which limited total spending and said you cannot prevent an individual from spending his or her own money to the fullest extent of bankrupting themselves. And so rich people today, under that Supreme Court decision, have an advantage, to wit, own money.
But they can't lend it to their wife.
No, unless they want to pay gift tax. If they want to pay gift tax, they can.
Or borrow it from a trust. We have just half a second.
Yes, listening to you, are your ambitions now focused on New York City? Because reading your book and listening to you today, you do seem to be focusing on mainstream in one city.
I will never run for another office other than re-election as mayor. I tried once. I ran for governor. I lost. Don't you remember?
I do indeed. But after all, people come back. People try for other things.
Not I.
Thank you very much, Mayor Koch. Thank you very much, Mr. Peter Riddle. And thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, from the Community Service Society, RSVP. Yes. Well done, Bob. You're terrific.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations: the Mobil Corporation, Dow Chemical Company, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.